I'm going back someday. Dr. Akkerman, in this discussion for music business, we're going to talk about the music publishing business, and we'll use this song, Blue Bayou, as an example. In the early 20th century, a composer or songwriter of popular music would have made most of their money through the dissemination of sheet music. Therefore, a successful composer would have needed a company that could set that music to print, distribute it to the public, collect money, and give that money to the composer. Well, today, songs generate revenue in many other lucrative ways besides sheet music, but the term publisher is still used to refer to the companies that handle all of those details. In exchange for the service, these publishers collect 50% of all of the money that they collect. And then they give the other 50% to the songwriter-composer. Well, here are some of the ways that publishers generate income today, besides just sheet music. Mechanical royalties. This is a payment due to the songwriter every time a copy of that song is sold in any form. Now, for the sale of a song off of a CD or an album, the rate is set by the US government. And they periodically meet to change this amount to keep up with inflation or changes in technology. So this is called a mechanical rate. Like I said, it changes, and I'm not going to really nail it down to what it is at the moment because it changes all the time, and by the time you hear this, it could be out of date. But let's just say at the moment it's about a dime for every copy of a song that gets sold. The songwriter picks up 10 cents. Publishers love it when a song can be recorded by several different artists because that multiplies their opportunities to get money for that song. So publishers love, for instance, Christmas songs because many different artists will all record their own version of the same song. Another way that publishers generate money from a song is placement in advertising, television shows, movies, things like that. So when you hear a popular song in one of these media, chances are that the publisher worked really hard to negotiate the placement of that song where you've heard it. And unlike the government-mandated mechanical royalty rate, when a song gets placed in a commercial or a movie, that rate is negotiated completely between the publisher and whoever is making that product. And it's really determined by supply and demand. The more popular the song, the more money someone's going to have to pay to use that song in their product. Now keep in mind, I'm only referring to the right to use a song, not the right to use a specific recording of that song. A separate license is needed to use to get the right to use an original master of a song. So for instance, a car company might pay for the right to use the song Blue Bayou in a new ad that's coming up. But they don't actually, by default, get the right to use the Roy Orbison version of that song. That would require a separate license with the record company that owns the master recording for Blue Bayou sung by Roy Orbison. So that's why when you see a car commercial that has a popular song in it, you're not always hearing the original recording. You're often hearing a cover version of the song. And that's often because the car company was able to get the rights to the song, but not able to procure the rights to a particular recording because it's just too expensive. We seldom ever hear an actual Beatles recording in a commercial, for instance. We might hear one of their songs once in a while, But the Beatles are very protective of their original master recordings. Another revenue generation source for publishers is, of course, print sales. This includes traditional sheet music, but also lyrics. And occasionally some artists will put out books of just their lyrics. And they also now have digital forms of print media. So a digital download of the sheet music will also generate a royalty payment eventually gets to the songwriter through the publisher. Also, if a song becomes popular in another country, a publisher may not have the resources or to collect money in that other country. So they will create sub-publishing agreements with a publishing company that is located in those other companies. So a popular American publisher might have lots of sub-publishing agreements all over the world with other publishing companies, and they all exchange resources that way. So you might want to ask yourself, okay, why would a songwriter want to give half, 50% of their hard-earned money away to some business suit who doesn't have any artistic ability whatsoever? Why are they making so much money off of your song, you might ask? Why not just handle the publishing yourself and keep 100% of the money? And that is a very fair question. And on a small level, you might be able to do a fine job. But for any real success on a large scale, you pretty much need a company that has all of the connections and networking already in place so that your song can get placed in ways that you would probably never have access to. If a bank is considering a new song for an international ad campaign, do you have any way of getting your song considered for that usage? If your song becomes popular in a small African nation, do you have any way of collecting royalties off of the use of your song in a video that's popular there? If Faith Hill is looking for songs for her next CD, do you have any way of getting a song demo to her? I mean, maybe you know a friend of the bus driver who once worked on her tour, but you probably don't. Whereas a publisher does have access, or at least the potential for access. It really comes down to the idea that 50% of something is way better than 100% of nothing. So if you've got some great songs, and you're hoping to make a little money off of those down the road, you pretty much need to get yourself a major publisher, and who knows? Maybe your song will be heard on the next big album from the next big artist. Good luck.